Shalom, Ras Teferi, Salam Tena, Tena Yisalim. I am Alonzo, and we are coming to all from Rastafari Fellowship YouTube channel. And we want to give thanks to everyone that supports Rastafari Fellowship, that makes it possible, even all them that make the Lion of Judah Society possible, Ethiopian World Net, Ethiopian World Net 911, Rastafari Sabbatical, and any of the many, many, many different pages out there, channel pages on YouTube put out by our brothers and sisters, members in Christ. We give thanks to everyone, whether they be Rastafari, whether they be considering it, whether they be heathen, whether they be, you know, just curious individuals. You know, we give thanks whether they watch the one video or 2 minutes of a video. You know, we give thanks to all. We greatly appreciate everyone's support, and we say this because we've seen such a gigantic leap in as far as Ras Teferi coming closer together and making itself manifest in such a way so rapidly, and you know, so many things. Many cannot see this, right? But you know, trust that we speak truth, and things are coming along fairly well. We could do more, and but nonetheless, there's been like a gigantic increase in the last few years, we would say, especially in knowledge, and you know, a lot of individuals in the family stepping up. We give thanks. We're proud of everyone. Personally, we've met and come across and been united with the family that we forgot we had, and we've known the bestest brothers and sisters and uncles and aunts and grandpas and grandmas, and you know, and all of that, you know, cousins, that the best that Jah has to offer. It's all in Ras Teferi. We extend our hands out to anyone out there considering kind of playing with the idea of Ras Teferi. Listen, I mean, if this can encourage you, then let it be so. This is our Father's world. In and through Christ Jesus, we exercise authority and dominion over this world and know it for a fact. Pretty much, it's all in our hands now. Our Father made his visitation. You know, he fulfilled his part, I mean, the part of the book as far as what was written for him to fulfill in a manifestation of his kingly character. And you know, he prepared the ground, he set the foundation, he planted the seed. And like he said, you know, like, yeah, I'm a man, and I'm gonna be replaced by the oncoming generation. And we say that fortunate are we to take part of that oncoming generation, which is to set him in order, to set his house in order, and to replace him, rightfully place him in his location, and upon the throne of the universe, of all that exists, you know, with Geta Jesus alongside, to whom all was given. And so yeah, basically, it's what we're trying to say. It's all in our hands now. From here on, like, the world is in our hands. It's you know, regardless of from now on, it's patience, the patience of the saint, of the saints, you know. But if we want to bring this about quicker and faster, you know, let us walk that exemplary life of Geta Jesus. There is nothing more powerful than to seek to do the good and to live that good exemplary life that Jesus Christus has provided for us. Forget about, you know, feeding the hungry, and forget about, I mean, those things, yeah, they do some good, but it don't compare to what living as closely as possible to Jesus Christus has to offer. It's a force without measurement. We gotta understand, we gotta accept that, and really comprehend and grasp, and really, really consider what it is to have Kedamawi Haile Selassie as a father, and Geta Jesus Christus as an eldest brother, and salvation. If you overs what that signifies, that means that your father is the creator of all, and your eldest brother, by him, through him, for him, and without him, I mean, By him, through him, for him, all was created, and without him, nothing can be. Just think about that. I mean, it would be foolish to even think that a Rastafari in spirit and truth blinking is not gonna cause some corrupt individuals to, to be put down, to be put away. So it's what I'm trying to express is the magnitude of the situation. You know, every thought, every action, every word that Rastafari speaks, every breath that we take is a force beyond measure of itself that is to be reckoned with. And it's the more we exercise our power and authority in Geta Jesus, the faster we bring about our, the establishment of truth for all eternity. It's as simple as that. But, let's not be. Many cannot see how everything's coming together, but just know that it is. But I speak of a truth when I make mention that everything is coming together. We need to walk in the exemplary life of Geta Jesus, and we need to speak truth. You know, when we say something, it's a vibration so gigantic, and thus it becomes and manifests into an energy so potentially, like, not harmful, but rather like of good, beneficial, that it brings about the destruction of all evil even quicker. So we speak truth, and it's like, some wicked people be put away halfway across the world. We do a good deed, and it's like some children don't go don't you know don't get jumped in a gang. We meditate and we pray and we study scripture, and a drug cartel did not get their dope on time, and therefore, they got caught or something. So yeah, it's if you want to laugh and think that this isn't serious, then maybe you don't know who your father is. But if you know who your father is, then you know what kind of authority we exercise. So yeah, do anything that ones can do, but most of all, study, pray, and this, this above all things is to be taken seriously, our relationship with Abba. I myself am we've had it, but honestly, we had not received how important it really is to have a relationship. And even though we've been fortunate to exercise it, but not consciously, listen, what we're trying to say is, ever since, I believe it's Exodus chapter 19, the Almighty appears to Moses, and he says, yeah, I want these people to be a priesthood, and they're going to be my priesthood, and yeah, it's going to be great. So Moses goes, so Jah tells Moses, tell the people that, yeah, I want them to be my people, and this and that, and stuff like that. And so Moses is kind of like, hey, is, Israel hoy, Yahweh Elohim, Yahweh Elohim said, he said that we're going to be this and that. And so what does Israel do? Israel is like, oh yeah, whatever, yeah, tell that. It's almost like they, I mean, it doesn't say it right, but it kind of gives the impression that they're kind of like, yeah, tell that dude that, yeah, tell that guy that, yeah, sure, he could be our God. Whatever he says, we'll do. And so Moses goes up to Jah, and Jah's like, oh, all right. So I wasn't, I never said anything about wanting them to do anything. I never. So now, I mean, they're exercising authority to speak like for me. All right. So they want to set boundaries. They want to set limits. I'm gonna tell them how far they can go. And so that's what you want to do. All right. Everything that I say, they messed up. Israel messed up. What they did, they turned it into a contract. They didn't want to walk by faith. If they would have just been like, yeah, that's cool. Yeah. Wow, we're gonna be a priest. No, they had to be, yeah, sure. It's like, it's on us. Anything he says, we will do. Yeah, we'll make sure that we do. They didn't want to walk by faith, They didn't wanna just accept it and believe it to be what it was without even having to do anything. So right off the bat, I mean, goodbye, grace. And so now, it goes on to chapter 20 and the Decalogue, and then all the people are panicked and they're tripping out, right? And so Moses goes up to them, and he'd be like, nah, don't trip, everything's cool, everything's cool. It's like, that's our salvation. He's gonna redeem us. It's our savior right there. That's Jah Almighty. Don't fear. And so the people, Israel, they're like, nah, you know what, Moses, we told you that anything that he says we'll do, nah. It's like, we really don't want to deal with him. We don't even want to see him, as a matter of fact. We'll do, tell him to tell you, and whatever he tells you, we'll do as you say. Yeah, we change our mind. We don't want to deal with the Almighty. As a matter of fact, we don't even want to see him. Let him tell you, and whatever you say, we'll do. You see, it's that's pretty bad, man. That's I mean, and you can still see it up to this day. Avoid it. They want to play with idols. They want to play with make believe, because make believe will not say anything, and Jah will shoot his arrows at you. He'll straighten you up. So I'm pretty sure that they know that. So it's like, if people accept His Imperial Majesty to be, who he be, and he can't be anything else, that means that they gotta get their act together, and they gotta start walking. Because what? I mean, His Majesty was a man, and he proved everything and did everything in and through faith in Getah Yesus. What does that mean? That means that you ain't got no excuse to be acting the way that you're acting. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, nah, they rather pretend that on imaginary things, that way they can live an imaginary religion where, oh no, God didn't mean that. He meant we got to do it this way. And since they're not talking about anything real, nothing's gonna really correct them. And so in a way, that's kind of like the veil. They themselves kind of like, nah, we don't want to see Jah, because if we see Jah, it's like we're gonna have to get straightened out. But really, I mean, it's not that we went off topic, but we got carried away with that. But it's needed. But so let us go forward to the first encounter of Moses and Jah, not the burning bush, but in this situation, when he lets Moses know that the people of Israel are to be a priesthood and a nation of priests, right? And so, it's kind of like a marriage, because I mean, Israel would says that yeah, whatever he says we'll do, like we will, they took on that covenant, that agreement, we will. But if we wish to see it in that manner, in like a marriage, then it's like, if you get married and your wife is like, is like, all right, we're married now, so yeah, that's cool, whatever you say, I'll do. And then the husband gets home from work, and there's no food and stuff like that, and he let's pretend it's a really good case where the man is kind of like in his ras, and so he don't flip out and get out of control. So he takes on the situation, correctly, and addresses the issue. Well, wife, I did work all day to provide for I and I, and I mean, if something happened, I mean, let's, we know that stuff happens, but we're kind of hungry, you know what I'm saying? It's like, what's going on? Oh, well, yeah, you didn't tell me that you wanted food. So it's kind of like, so the husband's gonna be like, all right, yeah, sure. He's not even gonna say anything, right? But he's gonna be pissed off, and he's gonna, and most of all, I mean, more important than that, it's what kind of relationship is that, where you are only willing to do that which you are told? It kind of like cancels out love and the desire. Jah wants us to desire him. It's like he wants us to be after him and be like doing stuff out of our own will. you don't want us to wait for instructions, because then it kind of like takes the meaning out of it. So it's kind of like the situation where, it's towards the end of chapter 19 where Jah tells Moses, all right, tell the people to come up here. And then Moses is all like, nah, because they can't come up here because you set boundaries. You said that they couldn't go past this mountain. And so Jah, he got irritated. He got kind of upset. And the way he responded, he yells and he's all like, Moses, get out of my sight, Moses. Get thee down or something like that. Like get down and tell the people not to cross the borders because they'll surely be killed. And so basically what we're trying to bring into evidence with that is personally I know that Jah was kind of like hoping that the people would break the blinds and jump the fence, or whatever, even if they set up like a fence and stuff like that. Jah wanted a people that loved him and desired him and were willing to do whatever to be close to him and a part and become a part of him. And so like it's like Moses messed up. Well, I mean the people, I don't think they, I mean scripture doesn't kind of like lead us to believe that the people were even willing to desire him. But imagine that the people would have crossed the lines and or the borders, and they would have ran after Jah. It's like, nah, man, this is God. I want to see what's up, even if just to see. And imagine, would Jah have killed them? I doubt that. I doubt that. I think that it was something that really kind of like it hurt him, because he just saved these people out of Egypt, and people are acting like brats, And the reason that we conclude that is because it's New Testament. When Jesus Christus is walking along, and then there's a multitude of people, and the lady that has been in a in that has had a running issue for like 12 years, she's like, if only I could touch. I mean, if only. I mean, just like the little corner of Jesus's garment, like I'll be all right. And so she goes ahead and touches Jesus in the border of his garment. Jesus turns around. It's like all right, some what is that word? I perceive that virtue has gone from me. Who was it? And his disciples be like, man, come on, Jesus. It's like you could see. It's like it's not even no space to be walking, man. What do you mean who touched you? And so, but what I'm thinking is that Jesus, I mean, I'm sure many bumped into him, but what I'm thinking is that Jesus felt the desire and the like. I don't know what virtue is, and I haven't looked it up or anything, and I could be wrong. This is an opinion. For the record, this is an opinion. I have no evidence to back it up, but I think that what Jesus felt was that I feel the will and the faith that someone is exercising, and that hope that by just touching me, even if the corner or border of my garment will make them whole, will make them pure and holy and bring them to health. And so I'm thinking that's what he meant by I sense that virtue has gone from me. And so how did he respond? The lady confessed, and he's all like, "Your faith has made you clean, has made you whole. Go on, just go on," he must say. And so, it's like I'm thinking that's the only evidence I got to back it up. But I mean, it's an opinion, but I think that is in fact the I mean, at least the emotion behind those scriptures. But back to the main point, it's that when you exercise a relationship with the Almighty, I've noticed that everything comes along way, way better. And it's not because you deserve it. It's not because we're good. It's because you're interacting, you know, and so you're acting like a child. It's like, Dad, did I do that wrong? Do you think I should be doing this? Do you think I should I have done the other thing? And believe I when I say that you'll get questions answered, you'll see things happen because that means that our father can start, being a father to a son. But if you know, and that I'm sure that has to do with prayer. But I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that prayer doesn't necessarily have to mean that to read verses and stuff like that. Although I could be wrong. Maybe excuse that because I don't have a word to describe what I'm trying to say. But what I'm talking about is kind of like just be meditating and be talking to Jah all the time. It's like, if something didn't happen, to feel like in a good enough relationship with communication, and you could talk things over and be like, all right, Jah, I know you want the best for me, but how come it didn't happen? Do you think I should have done something else? What was it that I did wrong? What should I have done? What would you have wanted me to do? And that right there, it's an opinion, but that is strength because that is a relationship, and that is when a father can act like a father towards a son and be like, come on, get in the car, I'm gonna teach you how to drive. Because the son was like, Dad, when are we gonna go driving, and when can you teach me, or what kind of things should I do for you to allow me, grant me that privilege, if I clean my room for a week, but you're interacting, you're kind of like, you're right there, you're kind of pulling, tugging on his shirt. And so, it's something so beautiful, I would say. Most of us didn't have fleshy fathers, but it's because Abba, in many cases, he kind of like, no, it's like, this one's mine. There's a proverb where it reads that I'm not sure which one, but when I read it, it's like, oh, like, and it was in the beginning, right? It reads that I know something like, that thou has been rebellious towards all your instructors, practically saying like, yeah, you've never listened. I know you've never listened to anyone because one is your father, because you were only to listen to your real father. And so, just adding that to the presentation, and also the fact that sometimes Jah don't want outside influence to his personal children, because you gotta understand that he knows who his children are since the beginning. And so, yeah, let us end with that. But this is an opportunity for those that have never had a father figure to actually exercise a father-son relationship. And as a matter of fact, it's we give thanks because it's all making sense personally. What how it's been in our power to actually receive that which we thought we lacked in our in our experience. But now we get the opportunity to exercise that right and to exercise the relationship and love of a son towards a father. And so what better father than the Most High, Jah Rastafari, Kedamawi, Haile Selassie, and what better elder brother than Gita Jesus Christus, offering himself for I and I salvation. So let us conclude there. We hope that that we all come in a closer relation, with each other, but most importantly with the Father and our brother and the rest. It'll just come to be because it was written before. Everything that Jah says will come to be has come to pass, and so therefore we know it. We give thanks to all that support Rastafari Fellowship, Lion of Judah Society, and Ethiopian World Net, and there's so many stuff going out there, but we give thanks to all. Shalom, Rastafari.